Question 22. 116 people participated in a singles tennis tournament of knockout format. The players are paired up in the first round. The winners of the first round are paired up in the second round, and so on till the final is played between two players. Okay. If after any round there is odd number of players, one player is given a bye. That is, he skips that round and plays the next round with the winners. Find the total number of matches played in the tournament when starting with 116 people. Now, quickly you have to realize this is a straight up knockout format with bites. For example, when 116 people we start off with, 116 will become how much? 58 after the first round of matches. There will be 58 matches basically, and that many winners will come out through to the next round. And 58 people playing each other, there will now be 29 matches, and 29 winners will move through to the next round. At this point in time, because there are 29 people moving through, 14 matches will be held where 14 people will move through, plus one person left over, he'll get a bye. So 15 people will move through. Again, now 7 people will come through the 14 matches, and one person getting a bye, that will mean 8 people. Now, four matches, 2 matches, and 1 match. That's literally the counting. But notice I didn't bother adding those things while going through them, because I noticed a certain pattern. See, the number of people moving through to the next round is controlled by the number of matches being played itself. In fact, it is the same thing. So, for 116 people, and if you notice the relationship between the total, it's just one less. For example, let's start with 7 people, right? What will happen with 7 people? 3 matches will get played plus 1 bye. Okay, plus after that, well, 3 people will come through, and 4 after that, 2 matches and then 1 match. So total of 3 plus 2, 5 plus 1, 6. We started with 7, we got 6. If we were to start with 8, we would get 7. Basically, it's one less than the total number of people even taking part. So 116 people are taking part, 115 matches need to be played till one player is left over who can be declared a winner. So that's a 115. Moving on to the next question. Question number 23. If n is any positive integer, then n cube minus n is divisible by, notice n cube minus n, let's take out factors, because each number is a certain type of a number and you can tell what becomes compulsory. So for example, let's take n cube minus n. If you take out n out of it, that's n square minus 1, which itself can be broken up into n plus 1 and n minus 1. So effectively, n cube minus n is equal to n plus 1, n minus 1. That means it's basically a series of 3 subconsequent or consecutive numbers, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And n is any positive integer, so n can be 1 at minimum. What happens in 1? N becomes 0, 1, 2. 0, 1, 2. And that's divisible by everything actually. 0 is divisible by everything. But let's take now n equal to 2. That will give me a series of 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3, 6. And that's the lowest possible. So everything else from this point on, 2, 3, 4, will definitely have a even number in between those 3 numbers, because every second number is actually an even number and every second number is an odd number. So given any 3 consecutive numbers, you are guaranteed at least one even number, which is also divisible by 2, and you are guaranteed one number which is divisible by 3, because in every 3 numbers there is a divisor of 3. So in every subsequent number of n cube minus n, you are guaranteed a number that is divisible by 2 and number that is divisible by 3. So always divisible by 6, option number C, is the right answer. See how quickly we can go through these now when we know what exactly we are looking for. Moving on to the next question. This seems difficult to do verbally. Maybe. Let's see. The value of 1 minus d cube divided by 1 minus d is, again, it's that same expansion thing. 1 minus d cube. 1 minus d cube, now I don't actually remember the expansion. But I know I need to get it in the form of 1 minus d so that it cancels out with the denominator given below, which is 1 minus d. So I'm quickly going to construct what the other part is going to be. So if I have 1 minus d, the other part must be something. When 1 minus d is multiplied by that something, I get 1 minus d cube. Now what can that be? 1 minus d into, first I need to get 1 finally. So I need to have a constant term in that something. So there will come a 1. 1 into 1 is going to give me 1. That will be 1. And 1 minus d. Minus d is there. So minus d into 1 is going to create a minus d for me, which I need to go away because I just need to get 1 minus d cube at the end. So what I'm going to do is 1 plus d, because I'm getting a minus d, and if I add a plus d, now 1 from 1 minus d will multiply with this d, give me plus d, which will cancel it out. Now again the minus d will get multiplied with this plus d to give me a minus d square, which I need for it to go away as well. So again I'm going to add a plus d square. So 1 plus d square is what is going to be left over. Now 1 plus d square, let's take a look at the options given. What happens? Forget the options given actually. We've seen 0, 1, 2, that's the range. Let's just put in different values of d and see what happens. 1 plus d square. If I put in 0, the value is 1. If I put in minus 1, or okay, let's put in minus 1. What happens there? Then I have 1 plus d, which is minus 1, so that's gone. And then minus 1 whole square. That's still a value of 1. Okay. Still a value of 1. Oh, minus 2, what happens? Minus 2, 1, then minus 2, which is plus d, that means minus 1, plus d square, so that's plus 4, and minus 1 remaining, so that's 3, that's it. It's still greater than 1, okay. So in any decreasing number below minus 1, it is going to continue to remain greater than 1. So the first one, it's d is less than minus 1, not greater than. Maybe it remains true even then. Let's find out. Let's take 0. At 0, we saw what happened. At 0, the value was just 1. So it's not greater than 1, it's exactly equal to 1. At 1, positive 1, what happens? It's 1 plus 1 plus 1, 3. And greater than 3, if d is greater than 1, yes, if d is greater than 1, this value will definitely be greater than 3, because 1 plus d square will at least cross 3, positively speaking. B is the correct answer. I took so long to answer, to explain that question actually. Can be done so much more quickly if you are doing it mentally. Moving to question number 25. Gopal went to a fruit market with a certain amount of money. With this money, he can buy either oranges, 50 oranges, or 40 mangoes. Okay. So whatever money he has, he is worth 40 mangoes or 50 oranges, which also means 50 oranges is worth 40 mangoes. I now know one mango I can exchange in for 1.25 oranges, which is basically 5 by 4. That's the conversion ratio. Now, let's see. He retains 10% of the money for the taxi fare. Okay. So, whatever total amount of money he came with, which is, let's say, 40 mangoes worth of money, he retained 4 mangoes worth of money for taxi fare. Or I can say he retained 5 oranges worth of money for taxi fare. Okay. So, he now has either 45 oranges worth of money or he has 36 mangoes worth of money to spend on buying oranges and mangoes. If he buys 20 mangoes, then the number of oranges he can buy is, okay. So, he buys 20 mangoes, he originally planned for 40, right. As we discussed, he has money left over for 36 mangoes. And out of 36 mangoes, which is 9 parts, he buys 20 mangoes, okay. So, 5 parts of that he spends. He has 4 parts or 4 into 4 mangoes. Worth of 16 mangoes worth of money left over basically. Now 16 mangoes worth of money, as we discussed, is 16 into 1.25 worth of oranges, and 16 into 1.25 is basically 16 plus 1/4 of 16, which is 4, which is 20. 20 oranges you can buy. Hey, see, that's quick. The next one, question 26 to 28, deals with a certain situation, and it's 3 questions all attached to the same situation. Let's look now at what context is given. Question 6 to 28, the context provided: a dealer deals only in color TVs and VCRs. He wants to spend up to rupees 12 lakhs to buy 100 pieces. Okay. He can purchase a color TV at rupees 10,000 and a VCR at rupees 15,000. So, you have been told this person can spend a maximum of 12 lakhs and he can buy up to 100 pieces of TVs and VCRs combined, not more than that. 100 pieces of electronics, that's it. And unit price of color TV is 10,000, unit price of VCR is 15,000. That means he can buy 100 into 10,000 will give me 10 lakhs and 12 lakhs, so basically 120. If he bought color TVs, he can end up buying 120 color TVs with 12 lakhs, but he can buy a maximum of 100 pieces. If he were to buy only VCRs at 15,000, so that's 120 by 15, so that's 80 VCRs. So he will spend the 12 lakhs, but he will still have 20 pieces of quota that he can still fill because his limit has not been expended of 100 pieces. Only 80 VCRs he can purchase. He can sell a color TV at rupees 12,000 and a VCR at rupees 17,500. Fine. His objective is to maximize profits. Okay. What is profit per unit then? For a color TV, profit per unit is 2000 and for VCR is 2500. What that means is I earn more absolute money per unit of VCR sold. But let's look at profitability percentage as well, because it's not per unit. You're going to be spending a certain amount of bulk money. Per amount of money spent, I get 2000 on 10,000 rupees, so that's 20% profitability, and I get 2500 on 15, which is less than 20%. In fact, it is 1 by 6, so that's around 18% approximately, 18.66 or something like that. So, I know the per unit profitability or per unit of money spent, I get 20 paise per rupee spent, I get 20 paise return when I deal in TVs, and I get around 18% return when I deal in VCRs. However, per unit basis, I get 2500 rupees per unit in VCRs and 2000 rupees per unit in color TVs. I'm constantly talking of both units and per unit money spent and per unit of electronics, because those are the two constraints given to us. That's it. Rupees 12 lakh is total amount of money spent. So I will need to know these things in terms of per money, per unit of money. And 100 pieces is the total number of units. So I will have to know per unit what is the expenditure that's going to incur, or what, how much profit I'm going to get. So the objective is to maximize profit. So I need to know profit with respect to both these two things. Now let's quickly solve the questions. For the maximum profit, the number of color TVs and VCRs that you should respectively stock are, I know I need to get maximum number of color TVs in there, as many as possible. So let's try with the highest given over here, 80-20. What happens? With 80 color TVs, I end up spending 8 lakhs and I have 4 lakhs left and I end up exhausting 80. So now for 20 VCRs, I will end up spending 3 lakhs. That's it. 20 VCRs will cost me 3 lakhs. And so 8 lakhs plus 3 lakhs, 11 lakhs. I still had 1 lakh left over budget to spend when I did 80-20. So this possibly is not going to be ideal. Let's look at 60-40, the next after that, because TVs need to be more than VCRs because TV has more profitability. So for 60 TVs, I will end up spending 6 lakhs. And for 40 VCRs, oh, another 6 lakhs. Because 15,000 into 40 will be 6. And together, I will be able to get, well, 60 and 40, exactly 100 units. What will be my profitability? I don't have to actually care. I know this is meeting both the constraints perfectly. Whatever, and this has maximized the number of color TVs. At this point, you could think, hey, maybe why not take all color TVs and see what profit you get. Let's quickly do a check. If you were to buy all color TVs, right, and end up spending 100 pieces, we would end up getting 100 TVs. Let's look at the 80-20 case and calculate the profit there quickly. For 80, I'm basically going to get 2000 rupees per unit of color TV. So that's 80 into 2000, 1,60,000, and 20 into 2500. That's 2500, 25,000, 50,000. So that's 2,10,000 is what I'll get. 60-40, I'll basically lose the profits of 20 color TVs from 2,10,000. So 20 color TVs is 40, so 1,70,000, and I will gain the profits of 20 additional VCRs. So that's 2500 into 20 added on. That's another 50,000 added on, basically 10,000 more added on. So 2,20,000. So definitely at 60-40 it went up. You can check 50-30 if you want to quickly see, sorry, 50-50 if you want to see what happens. In 50-50, 50 into 10,000, 5 lakhs, 15,000, that's 7.5 lakhs, and five, that crosses 12 lakhs, you can't even have it. So 60-40 is definitely the correct answer. If the dealer would have managed, question 27, if the dealer would have managed to get additional space to stock 20 more items. So now I'm relaxing one of the constraints, 12 lakhs, 20 items, so 120 items. Then for maximizing profit, the ratio of number of VCRs to number of TVs that he should stock. So I know he needs to buy all VCRs because profitability is higher per unit money, and 120 units, 12 lakhs is perfect for 120 VCRs. So he should take all VCRs and he should stock, sorry, he should take all TVs, that's for 10,000, yeah, higher profitability is in TVs. So he should take all TVs and stock no VCR. So VCR will be 0 divided by 100 TVs, so B, 0, that's it. And the next question, question number 28, the maximum profit in rupees lakh the dealer can earn from his original stock if he can sell a color TV at rupees 12,200 and a VCR at rupees 18,300. So we already calculated he was earning 2,20,000 worth of profit at a 60-40 split. How will that change by? So now I am getting 200 rupees more per color TV and I had 60 color TVs. So 200 into 20 is going to be, is this 200, right? Yeah, it's 200 into 60, sorry, not 20. 200 into 60, that's 12,000 rupees. That's it. 12,000 rupees and VCR 18,300. It was 17,500 earlier. So that's 800 per VCR. And I have 40 VCRs. So that's 32,000. So a total of 44,000. 32 plus 12. And 2.2 plus 0.44, 2.64. That's A. 2.64. With that, we are now going to move towards question number 29 to 31 after